Hi, I'm Neha Pawar.
And I'm Tim Berglund.
In another video, we introduced you to tiered storage for Apache Pinot in StarTree Cloud. In this one, we are going to jump straight into how it works.
Well, not quite straight. For some background, I'm going to ask you to imagine that you are a wizard working for the Ministry of Magic. And there's a new Minister of Magic, very eccentric, very cost-sensitive, who has introduced some new regulations. So, you maybe are someone who's used to carrying with you in your robes just the stuff that you need daily. But now, you need to have all that stuff with you all the time. That's going to be hard. You're going to need at least a trunk to carry that stuff around in. There's a lot of items. Any item that you have, you need to be able to produce. So you're going to need at least one trunk, probably more than one trunk, to hold all that stuff. And that's kind of hard. Those trunks are heavy. You're going to need some hippogriffs to carry them around. And you can't realistically drive all three hippogriffs at once. So you're going to need some elf friends to help you drive those hippogriffs. And all this stuff adds up, right? You've got to buy butterbeers for the elves. You've got food for the hippogriffs. You've got the trunks themselves. This is a lot. It's a very onerous regulation to cope with. Not only is it expensive, but really, you don't need all that stuff. You're just responding to this new rule that makes you carry all that stuff around with you. Usually, you just need a few things at hand quickly. So in Pinot, not in Harry Potter, in a tightly coupled system, it's going to look like this. Pinot servers, and these represent compute. Each one in the tightly coupled scenario has a direct attached disk storage. And this is either direct attached hard disk or SSD.
And if you remember from the other video, this is what helps us keep the data access latency super low. But often you'd have to scale your compute just because you want to keep up with the growing data volume, just like in this case.
Right. It's a great way to have very quick access to your storage, but it's expensive to scale storage because you're scaling compute at the same time.
And also there's not much justification often given that the rate at which you're querying your older items is much lower compared to the recent data.
Exactly. Just like the stuff you keep in your robes versus the stuff you keep in the trunk. So imagine you see Hermione Granger in the hall being stopped for inspection, and she only has this little beaded handbag with her. They ask her to produce her ink and her quills, and she does. And Crookshanks the cat, and she does. And page 63 and 127, 511 from History of Magic, and page 394 from her old potions textbook. And she does within a few seconds, all those things just that quickly. You walk up to her and ask, how did you do that?
I put an extension charm on my bag.
Which is pretty cool. Now the bag is basically a bag of holding, and you can put all that stuff in it. What's this charm called?
It's called the tiered storage charm.
How does that work? Well, again, back in Pinot land, let's take a look. We might call the loosely coupled approach. And we got the same thing, right? There's still a compute tier. These are Pinot servers. And you know, you can have as many of them as you like. We're using three for everything here because it fits. There can be three, there can be 30, there can be 100. That's flexible. And some of these will have direct attached storage before. Some of them might have indirect or network attached storage, like maybe an EBS volume, something like that. So here, this is SSD. And some of this data in the storage tier can be in a cloud blob store, whatever your cloud provider calls it. Some of that data can go there, the historical data.
And if you remember from the table in the other video, this helps us bring our storage costs drastically down because this costs almost 1/5 or even lesser than the locally attached storage. And the best part is this is completely configurable. you can still operate Pinot in fully tightly coupled mode or in fully decoupled mode, or even go for a hybrid approach where you can say, based on what your definition of recent data is, that some of it stays in the local storage, everything else moves to the cloud object storage.
Yes, and this 7, that's a configuration decision I just made here in real time. There's nothing magical about that. That's one of the configurations you get to set for where data goes. This does sound slow, though. How does getting things from the blob store not completely tank query performance?
Well, there's a few neat ideas in the design that allow us to keep the latencies competitive.
I think we're going to need some more space for that. All right, tell us about these ideas. How does tiered storage actually work in actual StarTree Cloud?
Well, remember when they asked for a few pages from my textbooks, like 100, 200, and all over the place?
Yes, especially page 394 from Potions.
Mm-hmm. So instead of procuring the whole textbook and then processing the data from that textbook, just like Apache Pinot, we do a columnar fetch.
Right. That would kind of be the naive approach to say, well, let's get the whole thing from the blob store and load it into our compute tier.
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't want to do that.
So bringing back the Pinot servers, and then a cloud object storage.
Okay, I like your clouds better.
And let's say we have some Pinot segments.
Uh-huh. Remember, a segment is a chunk of a table. So a table is broken up into lots of these segments that are stored in the storage tier somewhere, some of them now in the cloud. And a segment is going to contain all of the columns in a table, and we'll just say all of the indexes in a table as well, for some range of rows. As that data was being ingested, all those columns were stored, all those indexes were built and stored in that segment. That segment probably originally lived on direct attached storage, and when it aged past our config here, we moved it into the cloud store. So that segment is now in the cloud, and the structure of the segment matters. Pinot's going to do some smart things here.
So let's say we had this segment that had columns such as country, browser, device, impressions, clicks, timestamp, and then you got a query that says select sum of clicks.
Okay, I like it.
From my table.
I like that table name.
Where browser equal to Safari.
Okay, so there are two columns I care about, clicks and browser.
Right. So now, many systems who do tiered storage, what they do is this technique called lazy loading. And what that means is, let's say your query needs this segment, instead of processing it where it is or just fetching what you need, you are going to end up getting that whole segment onto your compute,
which could be a fairly large file. We're streaming that out of the blob store, writing it to direct attached storage.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And so then
like the naive sort of caching approach.
Yes.
Bring it in, right.
Exactly. And then the hope is that, hey, the first fetch is going to be slow, but probably the next query that comes in will also need this data. So that query will work out very fast.
The sad part being that approach to caching is something that really applies more to data access patterns in transactional databases, in analytics databases. You don't always get that neat power law distribution of accesses that you want. And so caching like this, it really is a naive approach. It doesn't give you the performance that you want.
Exactly. With OLAP workloads that involve point lookups and slice and dicing of a lot of data, and especially now that we're saying that we are opening this up to a lot of historical data, this approach is just not going to work. What we do in Pinot instead is that based on the query, we will do a columnar fetch.
So the server, the purple, the compute node, knows the structure of the segment and is able to get just a piece of it, not the whole blob.
Exactly. So now based on this query, all we will fetch is the columns that we have for browser and for click. And we don't just stop there. Based on the query, we also know that, hey, maybe we don't need everything that we have for the browser. And by everything, I mean inside the segment, we could have a forward index, we could have a dictionary, we could have a bloom filter, we could have an inverted index. Similarly, for clicks, we could have a dictionary again, we could have a forward index. And we already know that we have a filter on browser, so probably we only need dictionary and the inverted index for browser, and we need the dictionary and forward index for clicks.
Got it. So you leave other indexes that are built on those columns.
Exactly. Leave them in the cloud. So we're doing a selective columnar fetch based on the query. And there's an even more advanced optimization. Why just stop at selective columnar fetch when probably in some cases we don't even need to read the whole column? So to give you an example, let's say we have the inverted index for browser. That's telling us that the value Safari is only in rows 1, 2, 10, 11, 12.
Okay, which is an inverted index. That's its job.
Mm-hmm. And the same for Chrome and Firefox and all the possible
values. It's actually
going
to tell you the rows. Yeah.
Right. And then based on this, once we evaluate this filter, we already know that, hey, these are all the number of documents that we need to look at inside our clicks column.
Right, because that's the data that we actually want.
Exactly. So here we might have 1,000 records, but all that we are going to fetch after we evaluate this is a few blocks of data.
Got it. And there's adequate metadata over here in compute land to be able to be selective about where those blocks are.
That's right.
Amazing.
And then not to mention the StarTree index. With that, Pinot can be even more precise and often directly fetch you just the row that has the answer.
Right, or the pre-aggregated answer just from the index itself.
Yes.
Okay.
And why is that important? Because very often the compute nodes that we use, they have a limitation in terms of the network bandwidth. So for example, these compute nodes could have just a capacity of 1 GB/s. So reducing the amount of data that we fetch directly affects the latency and helps us bring that down.
Right. In other words, StarTree Cloud is engineered to use the cloud tier in a way that's consistent with its characteristics and not just think of it as a slightly slower version of disk.
Mm-hmm. Additionally, if you had asked for data from several segments of Pinot, not only would we have processed them in parallel, but we would have also done pipelining of the fetching and the actual data processing. So to give you an example, let's say we have 9 segments that we want to fetch data from.
Right. We don't want to fetch them one after the other.
Exactly. Okay. And say that the parallelism at our disposal is 3.
Okay.
That means we can only do 3 segments at a time.
Got it.
And this, of course, is totally configurable based on the resources that you have.
The amount of parallelism.
Compute nodes.
Okay.
Yes.
Good.
Now, assume that every time you're going to S3 to do a fetch, you are going to need 200 milliseconds.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you just did this 200 milliseconds every time you are about to process these 3 segments, that means for every batch, you would need to spend 200 milliseconds.
Right, which seems like a lot.
Right, and this adds up. This is going to be 600, and then this is only going to get worse as you query more and more data. What we did in Pinot was, before all this, in the planning phase itself, we begin prefetching the data for all of these segments all at once.
Okay.
Which means that your first batch still does have to wait for its 200 milliseconds, but when your next batches are ready to process the data is already there. So you eliminate this 200, this 200, so your additional overhead to your query is fixed.
At really one S3 round trip.
Exactly.
And we're showing this with segments here to keep it simple, but the fetching, remember, is at the block level, and so this parallelism applies to the block optimizations as well. So you get a lot more speed up than even just the segment illustration would suggest.
And then apart from all these, we have another neat optimization. So it's almost like you'll be able to pass hints in through your configuration to the system. So
yes, like
you could say that, for example, here, if you know that you're always going to access the browser column and you may have a bloom filter on it.
Right, right.
So you could say that, hey, I'm just going to pin my bloom filters locally on the attached storage. And for everything else, I'll still keep it on the cloud.
Right, which would be a great idea with bloom filters in particular, since you know they're things that you generally want quick access to.
Mm-hmm. And this helps us with a lot of pruning upfront so that you don't have to get to all the complex query processing and the data fetching. There's also one additional thing you can do here, which is instead of you providing what you want to pin locally, you can configure it such that it just learns and does it based on your usage patterns.
So it'll get somewhat faster as you issue queries. It'll learn what things probably need to be pinned and pin those for you.
At a columnar level, exactly.
All right. Now, Neha, you led the team that built this. So give us an idea of what's the actual performance difference from the naive approaches to where we ended up.
So when we first started and we were trying some of these approaches that we henceforth discarded, we were almost taking 50 to 60 seconds just to run on very little amount of data, a very simple query.
Yeah, not good enough.
Yeah, and then after that, with all these approaches, with the pipelining and the block level fetches and the pinning, we are able to run most of our queries in just sub-seconds.
Now, if you want to see that work for yourself and characterize some actual queries of yours on data of yours using tiered storage, you can always try it yourself. Go to startree.cloud and spin up a free trial. You can load data, you can run queries, do all that on your own. If you've got questions either about tiered storage or anything about StarTree or Apache Pinot, join us in StarTree Community Slack. Go to this URL right here and you can find lots of people there ready to answer your questions. Neha and I are often there, lots of other folks too. We would love to see you there.
Thanks for watching, everyone.